Well, first off, I want to thank Steve for inviting me to participate in such an important program. Given the shrill voices one hears now, both in Israel, in social media, as was mentioned this morning, but also in the mainstream press and in the United States, it's really a pleasure for me to participate in such a reasoned discussion as we saw this morning. Now, before I begin my presentation, I'd like to share some of my own reminiscences about Yitzhak Rabin. I first met then General Rabin in 1967, less than a month after the war. He'd come to the United States, and I was an infantry captain in the U.S. Army in full uniform. And I met him, and I talked to him in Hebrew, and he looked at me a little bit and said, "What's this guy doing here?" So I explained to him what I was, that I was a Hebrew-speaking, American soldier. And he caught on pretty quickly. And then he asked me to do something. He said, "Do what you can to improve U.S.-Israeli relations." Now, if you remember at the time in 67, France, not the United States, was the main ally of Israel. But Rabin was right. Very quickly, the United States, under first Lyndon Johnson and then under Richard Nixon, became Israel's main ally. Now, there's another reminiscence I have of Yitzhak Rabin, which I think fits right into the discussion today. I was privileged to be in Israel in July of 1992 when he gave his speech. He'd just become prime minister for the second time in Israel. And he issued some words which I think are worth thinking about even today. He said, "Look, we are strong now. We are not isolated. The whole world is not against us." And he said, "We, Israel, are now allied with the United States, the strongest power in the world. We have diplomatic relations now with Russia, with China, with India. We are strong enough to make concessions." And he went on to the Oslo process and did so. Now, in the Clinton period, when Rabin was still alive, one could argue that relations between the United States and the State of Israel hit their peak. If you recall, that was when Clinton promised to maintain the qualitative military edge of Israel against all of its neighbors, most of whom were not friendly. The United States strongly supported Oslo I, Oslo II, and the Israeli-Jordanian peace treaty. And one cannot forget the heartfelt words that Mr. Clinton spoke over the grave of Yitzhak Rabin, Zichrono Livracha, "Shalom Chaver." And Clinton later said that he had a loving friendship with Rabin. Now, contrast this, despite the continued security cooperation between the United States and Israel, with what happened last year, when I think U.S.-Israeli relations hit their nadir. Defense Minister Moshe Yaalon described U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry's peace efforts, you recall the 9 months that he tried to bring about peace, as, quote, "obsessive and messianic." It was a period when Israel refused to vote at the UN with the United States to condemn the Russian invasion of the Crimea. And it was a time when senior officers of the Obama administration disparaged Israel Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu as, and I quote, "a no-vision small-timer who worries more about pleasing the hardest core of his political constituency than anything else." Now, what's been the cause of what I see, and I say this with sadness, as the erosion of the U.S.-Israeli relationship? Since almost simultaneously, Barack Obama and Benjamin Netanyahu took office in the year 2009. I'll deal with two things through the course of my lecture today. One are policy differences, and the other the differences in Weltanschauung, which is just a fancy German word for worldview. And they are really stronger between the two leaders and in any other time that I can recall in U.S.-Israeli relations. Now, I should mention that this is not the first time that Prime Minister Netanyahu had clashed with the U.S. President. Following the assassination of Rabin and the brief period when Shimon Peres was in power, Netanyahu took office in the summer of 1996. Up until that time, as I mentioned before, Israel had negotiated two agreements with the Palestinians, Oslo I and Oslo II, and the peace treaty with Jordan. For all these events, the U.S. was basically a bystander, a cheerleader from the sideline, as Israel and the Arabs negotiated directly. However, when Netanyahu took office, the peace process essentially ended. It was the U.S. and Special Middle Eastern Envoy Dennis Ross who negotiated the Hebron Agreement in 1997. And then, thanks to the Monica Lewinsky affair and Republican support in the U.S. Congress, Netanyahu was spared U.S. pressure to move forward in the peace process through 1997 and through most of 1998, until President Clinton himself mediated the Y River Agreement, under which Israel was to transfer 13% of the West Bank, areas C and B, to the Palestinian Authority. This led, as you all know, to the collapse of the coalition government of Netanyahu. In my own thinking, that Netanyahu learned a lesson from this, which was not to give up any more land because it's going to threaten his political base. Now, following Netanyahu came Ehud Barak, one of the most politically inept Israeli prime ministers. President Clinton was of great help, nonetheless, to Barak, helping him mediate with Syria, although those negotiations did not work, and also with the Palestinians. Now, you have to understand, from President Clinton's point of view, when he went to Camp David for the second time, remember Carter as Camp David for the first time, but this was the second Camp David meeting, Camp David II, he devoted 2 weeks of scarce presidential time to try to work out a peace settlement between Israel and the Palestinian Authority. Negotiations, however, failed, primarily because of Arafat's unwilling to compromise and his refusal to recognize that there was ever a Jewish temple on Har HaBayit in Jerusalem, a refusal, by the way, that we also hear today. Obviously, neither Arafat nor Mahmoud Abbas or their entourage had read Dr. Fine's book on the Temple Mount, if they had. Anyway, after the outbreak of the Intifada, just before he left office, Clinton tried once again, this time with the so-called Clinton parameters, for an Israeli-Palestinian settlement, which included giving 97% of the West Bank with land swaps and all of Gaza to the Palestinians, a demilitarized Palestinian state with police, Palestinian sovereignty over the Temple Mount Haram, and Israeli sovereignty over the Western Wall, and the Palestinian refugees returning to the Palestinian state, not Israel, plus an end to the conflict. Arafat refused to agree. In his memoirs, Clinton told him, at the end of his days in office, Arafat came to him and said, "President Clinton, you are a great man." Clinton, in turn, told Arafat, "I am not a great man. I am a failure, and you, Arafat, made me so." Clinton also warned Arafat that he was single-handedly electing Ariel Sharon, which, in fact, happened. Now, why did Arafat turn down Clinton for which was really a good deal, I thought? Now, I met Arafat twice, once when he was in Tunis in 1989 and once in Ramallah in 1996 when he'd become president of the Palestinian Authority. After spending a number of hours with him, I concluded that he was both an actor and a shook bargainer. He saw that he was offered more West Bank land under the Clinton parameters than Barak had offered him, some 91% in Camp David II, and he may have thought that with the onset of the George W. Bush administration, he would get more because, after all, as I think everybody in this room knows, Sharon had clashed with George W.'s father, George H.W. Bush, rather heatedly over the settlement issue. In this, he made a very, very serious mistake. George W. Bush was a right-of-center conservative. Ariel Sharon is a right-of-center conservative. They both supported missile defense, and were very strong against terrorism, especially in the U.S. after 9/11. You recall that Sharon had taken then Governor Bush on a helicopter ride in 1998 over the West Bank, showed him the 9-mile narrow neck of Israel between the West Bank and the Mediterranean. And George Bush, as he recounts in his memoirs, notes, "My God, the road from my farm to the main highway is longer than this." So he got to appreciate the security problem. And when Sharon first came to the United States, they hit it off very well in March of 2001. Now, by contrast, after the Karine A affair, now, for those of you who don't remember it, this was an attempt by Arafat, working with the Iranians, to smuggle arms by ship to Gaza. Arafat said and denied it, even though most of the sailors on board were Palestinians. Now, a friend of mine happens to be the editor of the Journal of Palestine Studies, and he recounted to me one day that he was negotiating with the Palestinian Authority and Arafat how many copies of the journal to buy. This is how closely Arafat managed the detail. So to think that he knew nothing of the Karine A is really absurd. And again, Bush, as he notes in his memoir, said, after that incident, he never trusted Arafat again because he called him a liar. By contrast, cordial relations between Sharon and Bush, and really a close personal relationship despite some disagreements, particularly after Israel invaded the West Bank in 2002 after the horrendous Passover attack and the real spiking of the Al-Aqsa Intifada. Now, a deal was made between the two of them in 2004, which is worthy of mention here. As Sharon was preparing to withdraw from Gaza, he said the withdrawal is part of the roadmap which Bush had proudly pronounced to the world as the way to a peace between Israel and the Palestinians. Now, Bush, in return, in a letter to Sharon that was certainly public knowledge to all of us who were specialists in the field, said that any final peace settlement the Israeli population centers on the West Bank would have to be taken into consideration. As he noted, and I quote, "In light of new realities on the ground, including already existing population centers, it is unrealistic to expect that the outcome of final status negotiations will be a full and complete return to the armistice lines of 1949. Now, please keep this in mind. Now, following Sharon's stroke, Bush also developed a cordial relation with Sharon's successor, Ehud Olmert, who was also a right-of-center conservative. And there were good relations between Tzipi Livni and Condoleezza Rice, as foreign minister and secretary of state. It should be remembered that Bush, in 2007, established a 10-year, $3 billion per year for a total of $30 billion military aid to Israel. And that's been coming ever since. But I think one of the high points of the Bush administration, almost to its very end, was yet another peace plan worked out between Condoleezza Rice and Ehud Olmert. And what did it say? It said return of 94% of the West Bank, 3% less than the Clinton parameters, a tunnel linking Gaza and the West Bank, a few thousand refugees symbolically to return to Israel, Jerusalem is the joint capital of Israel and Palestine, and the holy sites to be controlled by a committee of elders from Jordan, Saudi Arabia, the Palestinians, the United States, and Israel. And if I can give a plug to Dr. Fine's book again, that's not too dissimilar from what I argued would be the solution in to the Holy Peace issue.
Which was the article that included the book.
Yes, yes. Anyway, now, Abbas, who I also met in Tunis and also had long discussions with him in Ramallah, Mahmoud Abbas, as the successor to Arafat, was too weak to accept such an agreement then, by the way, as now. The main issue here was that Bush, like Sharon, together they were on the same wavelength. They had the same worldviews. The same, sadly, cannot be said for President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu, who came into office about the same time in the early part of 2009. In the Obama-Netanyahu relationship, there were clashes both in worldview and in policy. And I would suggest that the policy clashes were far deeper and far more complex than any of the in the previous 20 years. Now, before we discuss these issues, it's important to note, and before we get too discouraged after lunch, there are still major things tying the two countries together. I believe that President Obama is genuinely committed to Israel's security and has given more military aid to Israel than any other president in American history. Not only has he continued the $3 billion a year from President Bush, but added $250 million in aid for the Iron Dome. So I can say that he is committed to this. And of course, when he came to visit Israel in March of 2013, you remember, he said, Atem lo levad, the little bit of Hebrew that he knew, you are not alone. So try to emphasizing that point. Now, President Obama is also committed to maintaining Israel's qualitative military edge over regional enemies. And by the way, the meeting this last week between Ashton Carter, the American Secretary of Defense, and Moshe Ya'alon, Israel's defense minister, maintained that. And Carter was very clear to mention, Ashton Carter, that Israel's the only country in the Middle East to get the F-35, which is the new American Joint Strike fighter plane. And finally, President Obama is committed, as he's repeatedly said, to the concept of Israel as a Jewish state. Now, despite these important ties and the support the U.S. has given Israel at the UN, regularly vetoing anti-Israeli resolutions, there have been important worldview and policy differences between the two. First, in the realm of personality, of worldview, Barack Obama is a left-of-center liberal. Bibi Netanyahu is a right-of-center conservative. Now, if you look at in the last 20 years, Rabin moved from being right to center-right, and Clinton was really a centrist Democrat. So they were pretty much on the same wavelength. Bush and Sharon and Bush and Olmert much more because they had the same worldviews, almost 180-degree opposite worldviews in the case of Barack Obama and Netanyahu. And this really does influence their policy choices. Thus, almost immediately upon taking office, President Obama sought a rapprochement with Iran and later sought to use a nuclear agreement with Iran as a device to facilitate a rapprochement, an action Netanyahu saw as highly naive, if not stupid. Second, Obama has sought a nuclear-free Middle East. Now, while this is very admirable in theory, such a development would strip Israel of its nuclear deterrent against its much more populous neighbors. Perhaps even more important has been the disagreement over the peace process with the Palestinians. President Obama simply disregarded the Bush letter to Sharon, which I read to you, and really upon taking office demanded a stop to all settlement construction, including in the settlement blocks, the population centers, so to speak, around Jerusalem. It was downhill from there. For his part, I must say, Netanyahu made his own share of blunders, including, for example, turning down a deal that would have given Israel a squadron of these new F-35s for free in return for extending the 2010 partial settlement freeze for 3 months. In addition, when Joe Biden visited Jerusalem in 2010, he was greeted by the announcement of a whole bunch more settlements. That's like waving a red flag in front of a bull. Then after the Russians had annexed Crimea, the U.S. made a major effort to isolate Russia in the UN. And on that vote, Israel abstained. Now, the history of this is, as I was told, that, you know, there was a strike of the Israeli foreign ministry, and therefore there was nobody to come to the UN. Well, in my view, that's nonsense. Very easily, the Israeli ambassador to the United States could have gone to the UN and cast the vote. But again, this was insensitivity to a major American need, and this was a major blunder. Finally, and perhaps most important of all, Mr. Netanyahu made the unpardonable error of contributing to the polarization of political views about Israel in the United States by enhancing or by embracing the candidacy of Republican Mitt Romney for president in 2012, by accepting the invitation of House Speaker, then House Speaker, John Boehner to address Congress on the Iran nuclear deal. He has transformed support for Israel from something that was bipartisan prior to Netanyahu's taking office in 2009 to a very partisan Republican issue, something, if you recall, that prompted the walkout of many in the Black Caucus and many Democrats when he made his speech. Sadly, I'm afraid that a real improvement in U.S.-Israeli relations is not going to happen until one or both of the current leaders leave office. Now, maybe I'm overly pessimistic. On the 9th of November, just a little over a week from now, President Obama is due to meet Mr. Netanyahu in the Oval Office. We'll see if there's a rapprochement. If one listens to the kind words said between Moshe Ya'alon and Ashton Carter during Ya'alon's recent visit, maybe there is some hope. I'm basically an optimist. As a Jew, you have to be an optimist. So let's say, inshallah, let's hope so. Thank you all very much.